see everybody. Thank you for coming back. God bless you. We had a great service at 10. I trust the Lord will be with us and bless us this morning. And thank you for coming. Let's all stand and join with Brother Recipients this morning.
Page 384, please. 384. There are so many showers of blessing.
There shall be showers of blessing. This is the promise of God.
Oh,
Turn over to page 181, Blessed Assurance.
I got to tell you, the 10 o'clock service this morning, the last verse of the last congregational song, we gave them a B plus or an A minus. They sing pretty good, pretty loud. So that's what we got to compete with this morning.
But statistically speaking, there are many fewer people. So y'all got to sing loud.
Does that mean I have to compete with myself? Versus.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
My son had surgery and it didn't go as well as it was supposed to go. So I'm praying that he'll have a good recovery.
He will. He sure will. Somebody else? Ms. Diggy?
Continue to pray for Corey's friend. She had the cyst in her brain, and it's shrinking, thank God. But then she had some tumors in her stomach burst, so she just has a lot of health issues. And most of all, she don't know the Lord. So let's pray about that first and foremost, and just continue me and my family, and pray that we'll do what God wants us to do.
We will. God bless you. Go ahead, Ms. Jessica.
For my friend's 2-year-old daughter,
who's on the CS. Sure will. Somebody else?
I could pray for my daughter. She was supposed to start her chaplain job this last week, but then when she got there, she found out she had to have the virus test. And she hasn't gotten anything back yet, so she can't start till she gets that.
Sure. Anyone else?
Let's pray for this country and pray that God have his hand on it and it'll go the way he wants it to go.
Yes.
All those with an unspoken request, you can show up or raise your hand. We encourage you, invite you to join us in our altar of prayer or right there in your seat. You can pray wherever you feel most comfortable. We want to be sure to take time to go before the Lord in prayer. Please be blessed. Brother Rocco, would you lead us in our morning time of prayer?
Oh,
sorry, I'm trying to find. This is hard to see this. It's all mixed up. Seems like I don't know why. Give me a seat. When the children of Israel began to moan and complain at the water's edge about the shape they were in, then Moses said, "Keep the faith. God is on our side. He's gonna lead us.
Thank you, brother. Everybody that would come. coming in with G. So please just listen to the message in the song.
Bless you, Jesus.
The Father is a plan, though it's hard to see it now.
I'm
1 Thessalonians chapter 1. That's where we'd like to look this morning, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. Not unto you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Ghost and in much assurance. As you know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy of the Holy Ghost, so that you were examples to all that believe in Macedonia and Achaia. Brother David Finney, would you please ask God's blessing on them? Message and remainder of the service, please.
Father in heaven, do ask your blessings upon us this morning, Lord, and hear your word, Father, preach, and pray for Brother Joe as he brings the message. Lord, help us to learn from your word, Lord, and not forget what we hear this morning, what we've heard already. Be with us in this service, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother David. We'll be seeing you. So, last week I spoke about the Luke chapter 2, where the angels were keeping watch over the flock by night. The shepherds were keeping watch over the flock by night, and the angels came and shared the glorious news of the gospel. And we talked about this for a minute, how the gospel really means good news. And Brother Rich, don't let me forget, at the end of the service, I still want you to read your thing. I'm sorry, I forgot about it until just now, but I still like you to read that, okay? And so, the good news is Jesus came, and the gospel became available to one and all. And that's wonderful, wonderful news. And so what I'd like to do is just try and talk for a minute about the power of the gospel. And really, to look at the power of the gospel, it's helpful to look at some of the attributes or basic truths about God. And so that's what I'd like to do with the help of the Lord this morning. To look at the truth about God, the truth about sin, the truth about Jesus, and the truth about man's response or our response to the gospel. So we spent some time this morning talking about God in the 10 o'clock service and how that he's holy. If you can say that God is holy, besides him, no one else is. He is a standard bearer for holiness. And if you measure yourself against him, you see how far short that you fall. The one we're reading about this morning in the Old Testament, when the angels proclaimed the glory of God, and he saw God, all he could say was, woe is me, woe is me.
Yes.
And isn't that true? See, when we're in the true presence of God, we see him high and lifted up, and we see ourselves as we are, which is nothing next to God. And we can never be anything next to God if it weren't for Jesus,
amen,
who brought the good news and brought the gospel to life, if you
yes.
will. And so we see that the truth about God is that he's holy. And he's far different than man. And we see also the truth about God. He is the creator. Mm-hmm. Everything that is, everything that we are, anything that we ever hope to be as individuals, as a church, as a society, as a political environment, God's created us, friends. And God is a God of creation. Aren't you glad for that?
Amen.
You know, he could have stopped with the animals and never brought Adam into the world, and therefore never brought Eve into the world. And me and you, we wouldn't be here today. But I'm so glad that God is the creator. And yes, we preach creation. We preach creation
yes,
here.
Yes,
not evolution, not the Big Bang Theory, not anything else. We preach creation.
Blessing Lord.
As far as my family tree has been traced back, I've not found any apes or anything yet.
That's right.
There may be some people are pretty sure that that's in my tree, but I'm not. My grandfather's a lawyer, and he traced our family tree back to Ireland and Scotland, and traces back to humans so far. So God is the creator.
Amen.
And you know what else? God, being the creator, is the only one that ever has, ever can, or ever will be able to say that he took nothing and made everything.
Amen. Amen.
Isn't that something?
Yes.
I have science teachers ask them if they can take nothing and make something from it. We had a teacher once in chemistry that said they could do that, but that's not the truth. They started out with a little bit and made a lot out of it, but they couldn't start out with a handful of nothing and make anything out of it.
Amen.
And God did it. He created all things. And He created us, friends, this morning with a free will. He created us with a free will.
Yes.
So not only is the truth about God that He is the creator and He is holy, and I forgot one verse I want to read to you. James 1:13 says, let no man say when he is tempted, I'm tempted of God. Mm-hmm. Well, God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth He any man. Mm-hmm. God is holy.
Yes.
And I spoke last week about how St. Augustine said God created us with this God-shaped vacuum down in our soul. He did. Not only is God holy and is He creator, but we need to look at the truth about sin, how He created us. He created us with the free will.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And I'm glad that He did. I'm glad that He did. He did create us like, if you look at a swarm of bees, you have the queen, you have drones. And the drones don't have very much control over what they do, Brett. They do what the queen says. You know, if God wanted to, He could have created us, He could have mapped us and given us, engineered us so that we did only what He wanted us to do. But that would have been a different existence, friends. God created us with the free will. Amen. We have the freedom to serve Him, the freedom to choose Him, the freedom not to choose Him, the freedom to deny Him, to ignore Him. He even gives us the freedom to blaspheme Him if we want to. But with those freedoms are responsibilities and consequences. Mm-hmm. Galatians 5:13 says, for brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. We've been created with liberty. And if you really want to experience and exercise liberty, the Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty.
Yes.
I only, Miss Jackie, this sounds so backwards and wrong, but it's so true. I only learned how free I was when I gave my will over to God's.
Amen.
That's what I learned. That's what I learned. And now He's with me with everything I do, Brother Bill. Everywhere I go, all the decisions that we make, if we will allow Him to, He'll be with us. So He created us with this free will. Joshua said to the people back in his day, remember what he said? Choose you this day whom you will serve. Even back then, he said, the choice is yours. The choice is yours. Do you know what? The Bible, though, the Bible is full of stories of truths about people and the consequences that they endured that served the Lord and chose God. And it's full of stories and consequences about the people, what they endured when they ignored God, when they denied God. And thinking that about that, Joshua said, choose you this day who you serve.
Yes.
You see, some people call it the Adamic nature. That means the nature of Adam, the propensity we have using this free will to sin is present in all of us. It's present in all of us. It's we're prone to choose the wrong thing left to our own devices.
Yes.
But when we give our hearts and lives to God, when we accept Him, we express our belief in Him by accepting Him, and I would highly recommend following Him all the way into baptism, which is part of your, part of the public confession of your faith, which is the strongest testimony you can ever give if you follow Jesus' example and you're baptized. You know, we don't have to do those things, but you do those things, and you give your heart and life to Him, you embrace the gospel, you believe in the gospel, you express your belief in the gospel by your actions.
Amen.
And your actions don't just start when you come to an altar and get saved. They don't just stop there, they start there. Because once you give your heart and life to God, having a free will, it means something.
Yeah.
And having a free will, God says that He wants to finish the good work He started with us. Paul said that in Philippians. And He wants us to move forward. He wants us to do greater and better things. He wants us to make more of us, if you will. He's given us a free will. You can give your heart to the Lord and you can truly accept Him. And you can kind of just sit down on the seat of ease and cruise along. And you can make heaven your home. But you don't want to do that, friends, because wouldn't you like to take a bunch of people along with you?
Amen.
Don't you want other people to be able to share what you've been able to experience?
Amen.
Oh, the greatest thing about experiencing God is having the chance to lead someone else along that way.
Amen.
And friends, it really hurts. It really hurts when you see people not unlike us ourselves. Many, you've heard me share my testimony. Many are the times I said no to Jesus. Many are the times the Holy Spirit troubled my soul, spoke to me, tried to get me to use my free will to choose Him. And I would stubbornly, pridefully, for whatever reason, I wouldn't choose Him. And I'm so thankful he never gave up on me.
Amen.
So thankful he never gave up on me. I told the church this morning, I was listening to a song by the Parson family they were singing. It's called just that, He Never Gave Up on Me. And one of the lines in the song is, if you saw the man I used to be, then you'd know he never gave up on me.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
And so we use our free will to choose him, to accept him, to embrace him. I was talking to Miss Jessica and Jason about baptism this morning. I said, and so we use that, and our actions then move us from accepting him and being converted to following him in baptism and walking in newness of life. And now we want to let other people understand. We want other people to know. We want other people to experience the same freedom and liberty that we have experienced. And to think that God gives us the freedom of will to choose him. When I was at the Belleville Free Will Baptist Church one Sunday, there's a girl that came to church there. She was, I went to school with her and her sister. She's a couple years younger than me. She came there and she went to the altar. She said she got saved. And after church, Brother Jesse asked her, why'd you come to this church? Just curious, you know, what brought you here? She said, well, you're the Free Will Baptist Church. I figured I can get right with God and still do anything I want to. I got a free will. She kind of had it wrong. That's true. You can do anything you want to, but if you truly give your heart and life to the Lord, your want to's change.
Amen.
Aren't you glad your want to's changed, John?
Amen.
I'm so glad. There was a time on a Sunday morning I would do anything and everything to get out and go into church.
Mm-hmm.
You know when I wake up this morning, you know what I wanted to do? Be here.
Amen.
I wanted to see you. Wanted to come and hear somebody sing, wanted to hear somebody testify. I just felt in the depths of my heart that we would have a great testimony service this morning, and we did. And I felt in the depths of my heart we'd see some lost soul come to the Lord this morning. It did. But we're praying that maybe even before this day is out, who knows how God works, and we'll get a call that maybe that's happened. Maybe that's happened. But I'm glad God gives us a free will, because it wouldn't mean anything if we were forced to serve him.
Amen.
If we were forced to humble our wills to his, it wouldn't mean anything. But when we have that choice and we choose to, and you see the benefits of living for God, friends, it was best said by a friend of mine many years ago, and they said, the benefits of serving the Lord are out of this world.
Amen.
Isn't that true?
Yes.
They're out of this world. So many different things going on around about us, and so many things may or may not be going the way you want them to. That doesn't change one thing about the sovereignty of God.
Mm-hmm.
He's in control. If you trusted him 4 years ago, trust him now. If you trusted him 2 days ago, trust him now. If you trust him all your life, trust him the rest of your life. He's the one that's in charge. Then, to speak to the power of the gospel, it's important to talk about the truth about Jesus. And so I want to read to you over, let's see that this way, Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 8, it talks about the mind of Christ. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You see, the truth about Jesus is, if anyone ever lived a servant's life, if anyone ever lived a sacrificial life, if anyone ever, friends, was guilty of denying their own will and picking up someone else's will, the Father's will and our needs, it was Jesus.
Amen.
And Paul is telling the Philippians here, let this mind be in you, which was in Christ. This is important, friends. This really hits home, especially with what we're going through. Wherever you fall on the political scale, don't let it trouble you or worry you. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Jesus, being in the form of God, he wasn't just the form of God, he was one-third of the Godhead.
Amen.
It says, being one-third of the Godhead, he didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God. And even though he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, he still made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man. You talk about submitting your will, laying it down to pick up someone else's. Jesus was all God and was willing to become all man.
Amen.
And Jesus was all in heaven and was willing to condescend, come down to earth. And in being found in fashion as a man, being all man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That's the power of the gospel.
Amen.
Jesus gave up all his rightful throne. Jesus, he could have said no. He was one-third. He could have said no, Miss Diamond. He could have said, no, I'm not going to. He could have said, find somebody else, but you could search through heavens. There's no other land that was born to be slain from the foundations of the earth, Brother Brent. There wasn't. He could have said no, but he didn't say no. And he gave way with his will to accept the Father's will. Why? So he could become obedient unto death. Not just any death. The death of the cross was like the worst of deaths. It was the worst, most disrespectful death he could have experienced. And he experienced it for me and for you. So Jesus, being sinless and spotless, became not sinful himself, but became sinful because he took on our sins. So they could be nailed to his cross in our place, so we might know forgiveness of sin. And this was always the Father's plan. First, it's interesting how it says this. 1 Peter 1:24, who verily was foreordained before the foundations of the world, was manifest in these last times for you. It was always God's plan. It was always the will of the Father for Jesus to take this walk of Calvary's Hill.
Amen.
And even though he could have stopped, he could have denied him. He could have said, oh, no. You don't find anywhere in the scriptures where they drug Jesus away, kicking and screaming and crying to the cross. You don't. In fact, the Bible tells us, we read this morning, as a lamb before shears, as a lamb comes before shears is quiet, I'm paraphrasing here, so Jesus opened up his mouth, not a word. Though they said bad, wrong, untrue things about him, accused him of things that weren't true, they treated him miserably. It didn't stop him. He was truthful, and he honored the Father's plans that was laid in place from the foundations of the earth. There's a song I used to sing at Easter a long time ago. It's called Born to Die. That speaks about this plan. Jesus was born in the flesh to die.
Amen.
And he was faithful to the Father's plan. And the truth about Jesus is that's all the power of the gospel is rooted in the plan of salvation. Is rooted in the Son of God. And so no wonder Paul told the Philippians, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, because Jesus didn't mind to lay down his will to pick up the Father's will. And so all we have free will. But it's an honor. Isn't it, friends? I'm going to tell you, if you've not got to a place in your Christianity where it's an honor and a privilege to walk for him, to serve him, to be a follower of him, to let your light shine for him, then try and get to that place, because it's an honor and a privilege.
Amen.
To know and understand how much that Jesus was willing to give up and all that he's willing to do, so you and I might benefit from his loss.
Amen.
That's amazing. That's amazing. And we are surrounded, friends, every day by people who need to benefit from his loss. And we have a free will to choose to lift his name, be a light and a witness, and be an example, or not to be. And we have a free will to choose him or not to choose him. The choice is ours, but along with the choice comes the consequences.
Amen.
And they're dire, we talked about this morning. Then I want to look at about the truth about our response to this great gospel, this great plan. Our job is just to believe. Doesn't ask us anything more, just to believe. Can you believe that Jesus is truly the Son of God? Can you believe he really came down to earth?
Amen.
Can you believe that? Can you believe he was born of virgin birth? Can you believe that? Mm. Can you believe he lived a sinless, spotless, holy life? Was tempted in all matters like we, and yet without sin? Can you believe that? If you believe that, do you believe that then he took, though he was sinless and spotless, he went to the cross, allowed all your sins to be nailed to him on your behalf? Can you believe that?
Amen.
Can you believe that he could have called the 12 legions of angels if he desired, but he desired not to? That he was faithful to the Father's plans. When the thief on the cross reviled him and said, you saved others yourself, you're not going to save, can't you save yourself? He didn't strike him down. Can you believe it? Can you believe he fully died on the cross? And he rose again? Can you believe really he rose rose again. His disciples didn't come in and get his body and take him away. That he rose again, that God, that the stone that was rolled in front of the door was no obstacle for our God, and that he rose again. Can you believe on the third and appointed day he rose again, and can you believe that he ascended back into the heavens at the Father's right hand just to make intercession for me? It's all about belief. But you know what the Bible says? If you believe, you'll then follow that up with works. You will. You will. You're not saved by your works. No, no, no. But if you believe, you'll follow that up by works. There will be a confession to your faith. You won't be ashamed to let people know you're now a believer. An easy way to have that profession of your faith is through baptism. Jesus was our example. He was baptized. He says it's a purifying of a guilty conscience towards God. It demonstrates that you have you go in that watery grave. The old man dies. You die out to yourself and to the world, to your free will. You raise up a newness of life, walking in the new way. And that walking in the new way is the works that follow after your belief.
Amen.
Over in Luke, see, our response is so very important. Over in Luke chapter 16, story about Lazarus and the rich man. Verse 26 says, "And besides all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from hence." That just means that there's no way for us to get to God. Short of Jesus, there's a great gulf between us and God. And sin really speaks to that gulf. And the only way that we can bridge that gulf, we can get to God, is through belief and exercising our free will. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says it this way, "That thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." So that's just four truths, friend, four truths about the power of the gospel. And I'm going to just read one more thing as the musicians come back and you give us a verse of invitation. When we give our hearts to the Lord and accept Jesus, you know, a remarkable thing that happens is that the Holy Spirit now makes our heart his own. And we have access to a power, a supernatural power. We have access to the power of God. And I want to just read to you, it talks about there in verse 5, I think it is, about this power. But I want to read to you, not only are we benefactors of a free will to serve God, we're benefactors of this power. Now I'm so happy. Listen to what it says in Jeremiah 23 and 29. "Is not my word like as a fire, saith the Lord, and like a hammer that breaketh the rock into pieces?" We have a great power. Mm-hmm. We have a great power. Bad news comes, trouble and trials come, things come that get in your way, obstacles to your faith and getting to where you want to be. Churches are trying on every hand today because attendance is slow to build back up, not just here, but all across the nation today. But you know what? We have a power. Was it Brother Dave or maybe Brother Larry used to sing this song, "We Have the Power"? Remember, did somebody sing this song? "We have the power. In the name of Jesus, we have the power." This verse talks about it being a crushing power. Listen to what it says in Romans 1:16. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation." We have access to a saving power. If we have experienced it, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. There's others that need to experience it. And you and me, through the gift of the Holy Spirit, have access to this saving power to share with other people. And friends, other people need it oh so badly. This is what Ephesians 6 and 17 says. "And take the helmet of salvation, which is the sword of the Spirit, and the word of God." We have a defensive power to protect us from the attacks of the devil. Aren't you glad for that? Amen. Friends, the devil's attacks don't stop when you get saved. They're
That's
really
right.
going to start getting heated up.
That's right.
If you think he's not going to be on your case, if you think he's not going to be knocking on your door, if you think he's not going to try and distract you, you're mistaken.
That's right.
But we have the power. In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
We have the defense. And the last thing, listen to what it says in Hebrews 4 and 12 about the word. "For the word of God is quick and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. Here's piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, into the joints and in the marrow, into the discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. You see, the word of God can get in there and slice and dice, and no hard, stony heart can turn it back. They might say no to it, but they can't turn back the truth. And they can get in there right to the marrow, the bone marrow of the matter, as an example. You get right down to the nitty-gritty. When the rubber meets the road, it can see, help you see yourself in a way that only God can see you before.
Amen.
And when we see ourselves in the way God sees us, we realize how desperately we need Him. Mm. We need that saving power. As we stand, as the musicians pray to sing this song, we reach out to the invitation. I want you to come. As they sing the song of invitation, if you have a need, whatever the need might be, you can come and pray. We have access to this power. Access to this power. And it is a great, great power. And thank God for the free will He's given us to exercise and have this access. So if you have a need, you come as they sing.
Page 161.